Dawson's. Jeremy Dawson, do you want to tell us how you got involved in producing Wes Anderson movies?
Yeah, I came about it from the never thinking I would ever produce movies and never actually knowing it was something I would be interested in. So I had worked with Wes. I went to art school and got a photography degree, and I started working in movies because I'd gone to university with Darren Aronofsky, and I was in art school and kind of working on all these side projects, and he was making Pi, his first feature. And he asked me if I could help design some of the graphics for all these computer screens. So I did that. It went well. And I said, you know, I'm also trying some hand in animation. Could I maybe design a title sequence for the movie? And he said, well, try it. If we like it, we'll use it. And if not, we throw it at the back of the movie or something. So I made this title sequence, and the movie kind of broke out and did well and kind of established him. And I started getting gigs doing titles and design stuff for movies, and it kind of transitioned into visual effects, because he said, well, on Requiem for Dream, I have all these crazy visuals I want to do. Can you help me design those? And so me and this guy, Dan Schrecker, did all those. And at some point we were in the kind of New York indie scene, you know, working with different directors, and worked with Julie Taymor, worked with Darren. And then I got a call about this Wes movie saying he's doing this film and he needed somebody to help him figure out effects, and he doesn't want traditional visual effects. And that was for Life Aquatic. So I got hired for that job after a bunch of meetings, went over to Italy and kind of got stuck in this world of this giant, like, runaway ship of a movie, and had to figure out a lot of things on my own. And I think after that, in fact, it's funny, I saw Wes last weekend in Europe, and my father happened to be there. So he was sort of retelling a story from my father, but the way he saw it is I was there doing all these models and miniatures and underwater stuff, and he was making this movie, and he came over to the stage where I was doing this stuff, and I was saying, can you come look at this? And he's like, he suddenly saw that I'd set up all these things that he didn't even know existed, and it was all working and going. And he felt like the movie was sort of going a bit haywire, you know, out at ship with a ship at sea. And here was this guy who we didn't even know what he was doing and put all this stuff together. So I think in that moment he thought, oh, you know, you could help me produce these things. At the time, I just was only doing the production aspect of my own part so that I didn't fail at the job I'd been hired to do. But, you know, it kind of became natural to me because I'd studied photography. I used to work in sound stuff, but I also good in math and science and numbers and, you know, all the kind of problem solving things that I had always just used in my regular life became something that were sort of skills that could be additive in the producing sphere. So it turned out to be a lucky kind of scouting mission on his part. And from then on, I sort of produced in some capacity, you know, either as a co-producer or producer on all the movies since then.
And with the Isle of Dogs, what was the most ambitious element of that production?
I think the most ambitious element of Isle of Dogs was the scale of the whole production. It was a lot of, it's a road movie. And usually, you know, if you think of a stop motion movie where you have to make everything, it's smart to keep it a little bit contained. You don't want to have too many characters and too many locations. So you think of something like Anomalisa or something, which was, the execution was great. It didn't go to that many different locations. Most of the characters look the same as each other. So all those things are things that are helpful in animation. What's not helpful is to have hundreds of characters, mass crowd scenes, and a movie where it's a pack of characters traveling across an island. You know, because every shot was pretty much a different location. So over the course of the movie, we had hundreds of different, like 250 different sets that we were in, and over 1,000 puppets, I think like 1,100 puppets that we had to make the movie. Plus all these crowds, which we don't even count as full puppets, like the crowds in the auditorium at the beginning. And a lot of that stuff, it was just the sheer scale. And as a producer, just trying to have everybody not panic when they saw the to-do list at the beginning of the movie. They were like, we're never going to finish this movie because we did this on this movie and this on this movie, and this is four times as much. So really it was kind of like additive death by 1 million cuts type of thing that was the biggest struggle.
Yeah. What is your guiding light sort of as a producer to overcome all those challenges and to end up with a finished product at the end?
It's a good question. I mean, I think it's a combination between like optimism and cautiousness and faith and hard work and really thinking that, you know, the what you think is the way to do something might not be the way to do it. Like, if you can't afford to do it that way, if you can't do it this way, there might be a solution. Like, you, and the other thing is, we had a really great team of kind of people under me. There was Angela Poshet, who was our scheduler, who was literally masterminding just data analysis, so we could really dig in and say, Angela, like, if we continue at this pace, where will we be in December? And she could go in there and come back 2 days later with like spreadsheets and charts that were like, you know, bigger than us. And Simon Quinn, our line producer, who's very experienced. And you kind of just think that part of what's overwhelming about animation is the enormity of the task at hand. But if you break it down to, okay, what do I have to get done this week? What do I have to get done this day? Like, if we shoot 30 seconds of footage today and we keep doing that, we will have, you know, an hour of footage in X amount of weeks. So it's kind of like not panicking, I think.
What is, do you think, the sort of greatest strength of the film Isle of Dogs?
I think the thing that it does, I mean, I think one of the things that I love about it is it has so many different layers of, you know, classical storytelling layers, you know, kind of an adventure, road movie adventure with, you know, overcoming good versus evil, you know. And then you've also got this kind of tenderness, which is one of my favorite things about it, is the relationship between the boy and his dog and the kind of tenderness there. And, you know, there's the little scene on the raft where they're kind of heading back to Megasaki City and the dogs are talking, and then Atari, you know, he picks up and feeds the puppy, and it's just like, you know, breaks your heart. And I think also another aspect of it, which I think is interesting and became more sort of interesting as like all these different changes during the movie, we had, you know, all, you know, there was the Brexit happened while we were in the UK, and we had Trump here and all these different kind of places in the world where there was a lot of more of a kind of us versus them kind of dynamics coming out in the world. And I think that's one of the themes in the movie, really, is this idea of like these people who are stuck in the way where they want to use division to kind of hold power. And then these kids who really represent what's optimistic and the belief that, you know, everybody can get together and know each other and communicate and kind of connect, whether they can speak the same language, whether there are dogs or people, or whether they're mongrels or purebreds.
Yeah, it's like a real, you know, like it really encapsulates that politics of fear versus the sort of humanity in people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that was the language aspect. That was one of the keys with the language aspect of them. You know, the idea that the dogs were basically dogs. I mean, they walked on all fours. They don't wear clothes in our movie, but they do talk but they can't speak the same language as the people. And in fact, Atari has this whole scenes where it's just him and Chief, this dog and this boy together, and they're talking and having a conversation. But really, you know, what's very clever about it is what the boy's saying, the dog can't understand, and what the dog's saying, the boy can't understand, but they're still communicating, which is, I think, kind of really special and original.
Have you got any complaints from cat people about the movie, Jeremy?
You know, I'm sure that some of them, we had some on the movie, but I'm going to show you something. I've got my crew sweatshirt here. Hold on.
Oh, cool. Oh, great.
I'm coming back, people on live video. This is the official set dressing crew sweatshirt. The front of the sweatshirt had the cat on it.
Oh, cool.
The back has the Isle of Dogs on it. See, it says the set dressing, I don't think you can see that, says set dressing department, Isle of Dogs. So we try to represent, but yes, the dogs do represent the Kobayashi clan and they're evil. But, you know, I mean, I don't know. We did put a lot of cats in the movie and they weren't mistreated.
That is true. Jerry,
and we threw a cat out the window. So
is there, yes, you did. Do you have a favorite scene or a particular shot or anything that you're particularly proud of from the film?
I mean, I already mentioned the scene on the raft, which I think is so beautiful. Like when you watch that animation, it's just like when you see that those characters, you realize that those puppies are smaller than my thumb, and I've got a little thumb. It's hard to tell. You know, the puppies are smaller than that, and the boy's head, you know, Atari's head is like this big, in the size of a maybe a bit bigger than a golf ball. and you've got this amazing emotion. But I mean, other scenes that I really love, I mean, I love the really fun. I mean, I love some of the crazy visuals that are in it. So I really love the montage where they're, where there's that, we've got that, that beautiful 60s song, and they're marching across the island, and it's, we shot some of it with tiny scale puppets this big. And we call it, we call that sequence 22 views of Trash Island, because it's Trash Island. And it's sort of inspired by the Hokusai views of Mount Fuji series. And I can't remember how many were in that series, but it was our kind of little like homage to Japanese printmaking a little bit. I love that. And I also love the scene in the lab where you're just dawdling past these, because that was like the most intricate set of like working laboratory equipment and like spinning lights, and all that was in camera. Like it wasn't, there was no, you know, the, all the lights and all the kind of doodads that were whizzing and whirring were all physically there. So I've got lots of them. I mean, every shot as I'm going through it, I've got a lot of favorites.
Yeah, it's like very much a film, as a lot of Wes Anderson's films are, a film of shots and shot composition and how they play off each other and things like that. Was there anything fun, like from making the film? Do you have any fun stories or anything?
I mean, there were lots. I mean, you know, one thing that was, I mean, one of the first, I mean, these things always start small. So like when you're making this movie and the end of it, I can think back to like warehouses full of sets and puppets and, you know, things that we had to figure out. But there were a lot of really, I mean, from the first thing we did, one of the very first things we did is we recorded the hero pack of dogs together. So we had Balaban, Bob Balaban and Bill Murray and Bryan Cranston and Edward Norton, and Goldblum wasn't actually at that session because he wasn't available. But we did that first recording session where we got them all together in New York. And we went in this studio, which is kind of like a rock and roll studio called Log Cabin Studios in New York above Manhattan Center. So it's like a concert venue. And it's just a really funky old log cabin vibe. And we set up all the things and we recorded the whole movie, all their dialogue, all together. And it was just the most fun to be with these guys. The pressure was off because we hadn't, the movie so far, it was just a script page. And now these guys in a room. And we you know, we did that for like, I think 2 or 3 days. And we had, and a friend came by, and this is like a tiny little memory, but you like a friend of mine came by with a blueberry pie that she'd baked. And we sat there at the break and we went out to lunch and we brought the blueberry pie and Bryan Cranston gave it to the restaurant and had them heat it up for us and get some ice cream. And we like had this kind of homemade blueberry pie in a restaurant. And you're like, okay, we're just like a gang of buddies making a movie with these world-class actors. So that was the first early memory. And then once you get on set, I mean, the most amazing thing is we had so many artisans, and they were from like 20 or 30 countries around the world. And at one point in the movie, we had a Halloween party. And if you see, like, you've got all these guys who can make anything. I mean, I can't make anything. I mean, I can make a movie, but I don't make the movie. And the Halloween party, I mean, you looked around, it was the most amazing array of costumes. And then at one point, everyone was all excited about something. And the production designer, Paul Harrod, he had this beard and kind of long hair, and he's, you know, in it, he's like a 60-year-old guy from Portland, Oregon. And he suddenly shows up at the party and everyone looks, and he had dressed as Bryan Cranston's character in Breaking Bad. He'd shaved his head completely. He was wearing the jumpsuit. He showed up as Bryan Cranston in an homage to obviously Bryan being in the movie. And he looked like a dead ringer for Bryan Cranston. And that moment, which was those little moments of like just this bonding of this group where this guy was going to shave his head for the enjoyment of all of us in the middle of a movie that we were making together.
Oh, so cool. You've gone from making like credit sequences for an Aronofsky film about pie to eating blueberry pie with Bryan Cranston and stuff on the set of a Wes Anderson movie. Yeah. You're covering all ends. You've got an extensive pie experience.
Exactly.
What, Jeremy, what is it like, or what do you think the tone is of, like, what does Wes Anderson bring to cinema that is sort of that makes him stand out from other directors and things?
Well, one thing, I mean, whether it's a live action or an animated movie, he takes the same approach. I mean, he is imagining something movie. He gets it on paper with himself, with some co-writers, like in this case with Kunichi Nomura and Jason and Roman. And then he basically sets about just creating an entire universe. And it doesn't matter for him if the universe is on a train or on a boat or in a world of jogs in Japan. And when he does it, he's like, I think, one of the great kind of collage artists, in that he's absorbed so many references and ideas from everywhere. He's a film buff, but sort of, you know, one of these guys who can kind of, probably with you or, you know, all these books on the back there, but he can kind of, he can be going at a conversation with a couple of like people, and there's just so many levels of knowledge of film, but not just knowing the films and who was in them, but remembering specific shots and backgrounds and images and exact gestures people did. And all these things kind of, he loves so much. A lot of these come into play in the movies. So weirdly, he's almost like regenerating cinema through recycling it through his imagination. And I think the other thing he does is he's really like, you know, he's such a specific voice, but I think one thing that is very special about his voice is there's, you know, because people often, I mean, obviously visually he's known, you know, for making amazing visual looking films. The music's well known, but really, if you think about everything about his films, he's as detailed about every aspect, the language, the look, the editing, the music, the sound. And one thing about him is he always brings this, even within the humor, this kind of humanity, this kind of nostalgic feeling of like the of humanity that I think is quite optimistic. And I think that's just something that's really beautiful about him. It's like optimistic cinema without having to be too kind of pop or saccharine or, you know, the sort of mainstream Hollywood version of that. I think that he's able, like something like Rushmore. I remember when that was the first, I think Rushmore was the first of his I saw in the theater, and I didn't know him at the time. And I walked out of there just feeling so uplifted. And I feel like, you know, Grand Budapest had that effect. And I think that that is one thing. He's always really centers in on these small moments of humanity that people can relate to. The boy, you know, boy and girl, when your first love, and those nostalgic feelings of being a preteen and just thinking you had the whole world ahead of you. And so I think that's something that he really brings to cinema, is a kind of humanity and optimism and nostalgia for the fact that humans can be better. And hopefully that's something that maybe improves the world a little bit beyond just entertaining people.
Yeah, I think also the way the characters talk to each other in Wes Anderson movies have such this sort of very just cutting out the faff, blunt honesty sort of thing, like even with how Rex and Nutmeg talk to each other in the film. It's a very different to how you see other relationships play out on in cinema. Jeremy, you've got like Grand Budapest Hotel won 4 Oscars. You got nominated for Best Picture. What, you want to just quickly tell us what was that whole experience like? Because Wes Anderson has gotten some nominations for screenplay and stuff before, but that film really got embraced by the Academy in a way that his previous efforts hadn't.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was, you know, when you're making a movie, your head is so in the movie that you don't even really know what you want. You sort of hope it's going to be good. You like the script, you're ready to go, you hope it's going to be good. Then you just do your best and make the movie. And at some point, like, you don't really know, the world can align to your movie or not. There can be lots of random factors. You know, I mean, I had a friend of mine had a movie come out the day there was a hurricane, you know, nobody ever saw their movie in it. But I think this one, it picked up this momentum. I think we realized at Berlin Film Festival, the reaction we got when we opened at Berlinale, or the opening film that year, and it was just getting this crazy reaction. It was getting the same reaction from every country in the world. So at that point, I think we realized, oh, this is gonna do all right. But it really just was, it just kept this momentum. It kept going. And obviously the fact that it got embraced by other filmmakers, I mean, for us, at least for me, you know, obviously it's not about getting a trophy or getting an award. It's nice to be recognized when the people voting for these awards are other lovers or makers of the same craft you do, is what sort of makes it feel good to get that kind of recognition. It's like your peers are saying, hey, you did a great job. And there are people who love the same things you love. So it was super, it was fun. It was exciting. It was a magic ride. And in fact, the night that we won the Golden Globe for the, you know, for the best comedy or musical, I think it was the last award of the evening or whatever. And we were just completely unprepared that we were actually going to win. And they called our name. And I remember Wes was like, he started to go. And I was like, well, let me get everyone. He said, well, you better come up here too. And I was like trying to get everyone up there. And then we were so kind of dumbfounded that we didn't know that we were supposed to go backstage afterwards and like get our picture taken. We just walked back into the audience and went back to our seats.
Yeah, they do like a press conference like back there when you were,
we didn't show up because we were just we were just in the moment and nobody was really wrangling us well enough. And we just were kind of too excited. We wanted to go high five George Clooney or whoever.
Yeah. Oh, that's so cool. Well, Jeremy, all the best for award success for Isle of Dogs with the Golden Globes and the Oscars and stuff coming up again. Yeah, we wish you all the best with those awards. And thank you so much for talking with us today.
Thank you, and have a great whatever is it, night or day? You're in nighttime on the day, right?
In Sydney, it's 2 a.m.
I think so, Bill Murray's playing tonight there, or was that last night?
No, you're right. He is down here. Don't know how many nights he's in the Opera House, but he was definitely last. I think tonight, Friday night, he probably was in the Opera House tonight. I think so. That's cool. And I
was like, he was on his way, and he'll be back with us on the next movie. So we're about to start shooting the next one, and hopefully we'll see you again on the next cycle. But
yeah, no, it'll be great to chat to you about the next film that's coming up. Not that all the films are great, but Moonrise Kingdom is one of my all-time favorite movies.
Thank you.
So thanks so much for chatting, Jeremy.
All right, have a good evening. Bye-bye.
Yeah,
bye, everyone.
You too. Bye.